The Lords of the Ether, Grendel and Doc, present More Than a Feeling, where music is the preferred mode of transport for the discerning sonic voyager.
Good evening. You are listening to More Than a Feeling, presented by the Lords of the Ether, with me, Grendel.
And me, Doc. Tonight's show is a theme show, so our protagonists will be judged not on whether they are guilty or not guilty, but on whether their eternal reward is salvation or damnation.
This evening, we are getting them in at the Loser's Bar here in Brighton, a coastal town on a sea of tears. So check your optimism at the door, pull up a table for one, and put your future behind you as we introduce you to our tortured cast. Lovers, losers, and substance abusers.
Bruisers, boozers, and liquor store cruisers.
Criers, sires, and cold-hearted liars.
Whether hung up, hung over, or hung out to dry by love.
If you're grieving, leaving, or just plain dry heaving.
Well, our songs detail various kinds of loss. Be it lost in love, lost in jail, or lost in the off-license. We have taken temporary residence in Loser's Town, swinging down Suicide Street, dangling from the lampposts of love.
Kicking off with a painful memory for me, as I saw this next artist in concert a few years back, and I was well aware that the then object of my desire was in the audience at the same gig but with another man.
Oh.
And it sets the tone for the show, really, doesn't it? I think our man would have approved. This is Richard Hawley with Cole's Corner, the title track from the Mercury-nominated album.
Shadows hold by the dawn.
someone waiting for me, with a smile and a flower in her hair. I'm going downtown where there's people. My loneliness hangs in the air, with no one there real waiting for me. No smile, no flower, no.
Oh, Richard Hawley there with Cole's Corner. Sweeping weepy strings. This is definitely a loaf of grief. Good northern boy as well. The lyrics go, I'm going downtown where there's people. The loneliness hangs in the air. So he's on about social alienation here and not being able to fit in. He sees the city lights and he decides to go down there and try and pick up a girl and just doesn't and probably goes home alone, which is fine. The guy is a crooner and all crooners have a place in heaven as far as I'm concerned.
Saved then?
Saved.
Yeah, I agree. Here's a guy who is unwilling to mope around at home, so he dons his best bib and tucker, heads for downtown in search of love, laughter and a parking spot.
If he's going downtown, I hope he doesn't run into Petula Clark.
Depends how fast he's going. So proud is Sheffield, which is Richard Hawley's birthplace, of Richard Hawley. He's pretty much the favourite son, that the esteemed makers of relishes, Henderson's of Sheffield, actually produced a commemorative relish in Richard Hawley's honour. And I say, stuff the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. Give me chutney or give me death. This guy achieves closure through condiment.
He's a saucy guy.
Oh, what a ridiculous pun.
The verdict? Salvation.
Okay, this next song is a warning to all those complacent lovers out there. If you get too lazy, you're going to lose your love. And the lyrics go, if there's someone you know that won't let you go and taking it all for granted, you may lose them one day, someone takes them away, and you don't hear a word they say. So lazy lovers, beware.
You sheltered me from harm, kept me warm. Someone you know that won't let you go.
Ken Booth there with Everything I Own.
Everything I Own. I didn't hear him sing Everything I Own once. In fact, I'm pretty sure he sang Anything I Own all the time. You can't hear him say everything once in there, can you?
I wasn't listening.
You weren't listening? I'm sorry, listeners. Doc actually popped out to urinate during that track, so I was left here steering the ship by myself. But I can assure you that if you listen back to this track, it's called Everything I Own, and he doesn't sing it once. Apparently it was a mistake in the studio, and they decided to go with it because it was a great take and no argument there.
Ken Booth for UK Pop Reggae with Backing Band Sound System. Joe Strummer sang all about him on White Man in Hammersmith Palais, one of the greatest songs by The Clash. This was one of the very few reggae number ones in Britain, which hit the top spot in 1974. My mum had a compilation on KTEL Records, which this was featured on, so I'd put it on and have a bit of a skank in my front room.
Oh, what?
Shall we move on? Not as driving as ska or bluebeat or early skinhead reggae like Toots and the Maytals. This is more like a precursor to reggae lovers rock that came out much, much later. What's the verdict on this? He's realised his mistake. He rues it. He's lost her through complacency. So I'm afraid he's damned.
Well, he has a heart full of longing and loss, you know, to be sure. But frankly, he's a bit bloody needy, isn't he? I'm not surprised his girlfriend dumped him. I don't like that bit where he offers to give up his life as long as he can have her back. Well, his grief has clearly fluffed his sense of chronology. I mean, what woman wants to wake up to a stiff?
You like waking up to a stiff, don't you?
Pull yourself together, man. He's damned.
The verdict? Damnation.
I'm very proud to say that this next track is my first musical memory. Normally your first musical memories are something so embarrassing you'd never admit them to anybody, but this has stuck in my mind because it was one of the few singles enjoying heavy rotation in the Grendel cave. The other was My Old Man's a Dustman, which is another brilliant loser's lament. A hero here is pining for his daughter, which must rank as one of the more painful manifestations of separation. It's Chuck Berry with Memphis, Tennessee.
Yeah!
Long distance information, give me Memphis, Tennessee. Help me find the party, try to get in touch with me. She could not leave her number, but I know who placed the call. 'Cause my uncle took the message and he wrote it on the wall. Help me, information, get in touch with my Marie. The only one who'd phone me here from Memphis, Tennessee. Her home is on the south side, high up on a ridge, just a half a mile from the Mississippi Bridge. More than that I cannot add, only that I miss her and all the fun we had. But we were pulled apart because her mom did not agree and tore apart our happy home in Memphis, Tennessee. Last time I saw Marie, she's waving me goodbye with hurry home drops on her cheek that trickle from her eye. Marie is only 6 years old. Information, please. Try to put me through to her in Memphis, Tennessee.
What a corker! Originally released in 1958, it didn't chart in the UK until 1963, which was the same year that Chuck was released from the Slammer, following his 1961 bust for, and here I quote, transporting an underage girl across the state line for immoral purposes. Should have stuck to singing about it, Chuck. However, he made good use of his time in the clink by writing, fittingly, No Particular Place to Go.
There's a lot of stories floating around about Chuck and his various sexual proclivities. Should we judge the man's music by the fact that he's a sexual pervert and a degenerate? This is so classic. It's instantly recognisable. I first heard this covered by a band called Alternative TV back in the 70s, which featured Mark Perry from Sniffing Glue. It was a lot different to this, but I absolutely loved it then, and I absolutely love it now. It's a story about being separated from your kids, but done in Chuck style. So even though it's a real weeper, lyrically, he just does it with such panache and style.
Yeah, I don't actually think we should have been dancing around the studio to a song about a guy who's had his daughter taken away, but unfortunately that is what happened.
Maybe he was transporting her across the state line for immoral purposes. He's making the effort to see her, so I'm afraid he's got to be saved.
Save that man.
The verdict? Salvation!
Okay, now, country and western, the white man's blues has got so many classic songs about being a loser. This was a very, very difficult choice to make. We agonised over this
for a long time.
However, we decided eventually on this track, the king of country losers everywhere.
Oh, man.
This is Hank Williams' I'm So Lonesome I Could Cry.
I'm filling up.
That lonesome whippoorwill, he sounds too blue to fly. The midnight train is whining low. I'm so lonesome I could cry. I've never seen a night so long. When time goes crawling by, the moon just went behind the clouds to hide its face and cry. When leaves begin to die, like me, he's lost the will to live. I'm so lonesome I could cry.
Okay, put your hankies away, it's over. He may have worn a white hat, but he had a dark, dark soul, and that song is a classic weeper. The lyrics go, did you ever see a robin weep when leaves began to die? That means he's lost the will to live. I'm so lonesome I could cry.
Never made it to a Christmas card.
No, he didn't. Probably the only suicidal robin in popular culture. It's not happy. That steel guitar is just so killer. It's beautiful. It's so sad. His band was called the Drifting Cowboys as well, which qualifies as one of the greatest country and western band names ever, along with Gid Tanner and his Skillet Lickers, Mumford Bean and his Itawambians.
Are you making this up?
No, this is all true. Dr. Humphrey Bate and his Possum Hunters and Fiddling John Carson, although what Fiddling John Carson was fiddling with is anybody's guess.
Inland Revenue, take note.
Hank was a mess. He used to be managed by his mum, and his mum got rid of him. Then he was managed by his wife, and his wife wasn't overly keen on him.
Work for your mum, and then work for your wife.
Absolutely.
No wonder he was crying.
As Lords of the Ether are fully paid up members of the Temperance Society, he's damned.
Definitely headed for the ultimate basement, I'm afraid. Hank Williams and the word hope seldom appear in the same sentence unless it's followed by the words in hell, do they? This is the real deal. How's this for a story? New Year's Day, Hank's on his way to a gig, but his flight is cancelled. Now, flights have taken over the years many rock stars from us, and Hank's flight was cancelled due to a blizzard. He was therefore stuffed into a hired taxi driven by an 18-year-old who was stopped for running a red light. The policeman looked through the window, saw Hank fast asleep in the back with a bottle of whiskey cradled in his lap, and said to the driver, "That guy looks like he's dead. Take care." Anyway, they drove to the gig in Ohio. It wasn't until they arrived at the gig that they realised that Hank had in fact passed away in the back of the car 4 hours earlier. New Year's Day, 1953. Hank was 29 years old.
Happy New Year!
You. I won't say much more about Hank because I think it's said best by the wording on his plaque in the Country Hall of Fame, and it goes as follows. The simple, beautiful melodies and straightforward, plaintive stories in his lyrics of life as he knew it will never die.
Unlike Hank.
The verdict? Damnation.
Next up, we have the artist formerly known as Miss Peaches, singing a song written for her by her boyfriend. There is some controversy surrounding that issue. Who apparently handed her the lyrics, get this, when she visited him in prison. There's your loser's credentials assured before you've even sung a note. I assume the exchange went something along the lines of, here's your cigarettes now, give me a hit. Well, a hit was certainly what she ended up with. From the 1967 album Tell Mama, this is Etta James with I'd Rather Go Blind. This is gonna hurt.
James there with I'd Rather Go Blind. I'd never heard this till you played it.
Really?
Yeah. It's a belter, and it's like a classic Motown pattern with the horns, that kind of Steve Cropper minimalist guitar type of thing. Surely there are more pleasurable ways of going blind. Your eyesight's pretty bad, isn't it?
Only for reading.
I think she's been weak here, though. Get over in biatch. Get out and have some fun. I think she's been maudlin here. She's got to get her stuff together and stop moping around the house. Damned.
Yep. Afraid so.
The verdict? Damnation.
Right, this is from the film Oh Brother, Where Art Thou by the Coen Brothers. Fantastic movie. And this is the best version of this song that I've heard. When I first saw the movie, I thought it was actually Clooney singing, but apparently it's just them doing the backing vocals. It's about this guy who can't stay put and just goes a-rambling. He's too wild to live with his girl, so he leaves promising that even if she meets someone else, he will still meet her on God's golden shore.
It's rustic, it's rural, it's a pain-by-numbers mural.
Man of constant sorrow.
In constant sorrow all through his day. Trouble all my day. I bid farewell to old Kentucky, the place where I was born and raised, the place where he was born and raised. No pleasure here on earth I found. For in this world I'm bound to ramble. I have no friends to help me now. He has no friends to help him now. Never expect to see you again. For I'm bound to ride that northern railroad. Perhaps I'll die upon this train. Perhaps he'll die upon this train. You never will see no more. But there is one promise that is given. I'll meet you on God's golden shore. He'll meet you on God's golden shore.
Man of Constant Sorrow there by the Soggy Bottom Boys, sung by Dan Tominski, who should get credit for this because it's an absolutely brilliant version. The first version I heard of this was on Dylan's first album way back when, but this is so different and Dylan's version is nowhere near as good. It was written by a guy called Dick Burnett, though he apparently couldn't remember that he'd written it. He was shot in the face and was blind, so he wrote songs to support his family. I think he's spent enough time in purgatory, so I reckon he should be on the guest list at the Losers Bar with full privileges. I'm going for saved on this.
I love the way that country can turn the most wretched of circumstances into a jolly sing-along, which is basically what that is, and it's not exactly an ungrim content to the song.
Is that a word? Ungrim?
Ungrim? I don't know.
Grimless?
Ungrim, isn't it? It's like west of Berlin? I don't know. The guy will be saved in the afterlife, which is the way the song ends. And I think, way to go.
Saved.
Definitely.
The verdict? Salvation.
The protagonist in this next number is a classic case of a guy who's asking, why me? When he knows damn well why. He's dreading the justice that's about to be served, and he shows no remorse. It's Johnny Cash with Cocaine Blues. Don't forget to collect the souvenir set of Man in Black handcuffs at the concession stand, only $10.99.
Early one morning while making the round, I took a shot of cocaine and I shot my woman down. I went right home and I went to bed. I stuck at 11:44 beneath my head. Got up next morning and I grabbed that gun, took a shot of cocaine and away I run. Made a good run, but I run too slow. They overtook me down in Juarez, Mexico. Laid in the hot joints, taking the pill. Then walked the sheriff from Jericho Hill. He said, Willie Lee, your name is not Jack Brown. You're the dirty hack that shot your woman down. And yes, oh yes, my name is Willie Lee. If you've got a warrant, just to read it to me. Shot her down because she made me slow. I thought I was her daddy, but she had five more. When I was arrested, I was dressed in black. They put me on a train and they took me back. Had no friend for to go my bail. They slapped my dider carcass in that county jail. Early next morning, about a 9:30, I spied a sheriff coming down the line. A tenny coughed as he cleared his throat. He said, come on, you dirty hack, into that district court. Into the courtroom my trial began, where I was handled by 12 honest men. Just before the jury started out, I saw that little judge come as to look about. In about 5 minutes in walked a man, holding the verdict in his right hand. The verdict read in the first degree. I hollered, Lordy, Lordy, have mercy on me. The judge, he smiled as he picked up his pen. 99 years in the Folsom pen. 99 years underneath that ground. I can't forget the day I shut that bad bitch down. Come on, you gotta listen unto me. Lay off that whiskey and let that cocaine be.
Johnny Cash there with Cocaine Blues from the album Live at Folsom Prison, which, as far as I'm concerned, isn't as good as San Quentin, but great nonetheless.
This what, is, the prison isn't as good as San Quentin or the album?
The sodomy, is much better in Quentin.
Is that right?
Yeah. Is San Quentin crisp. This is a great loser's song for junkies, prisoners and murderers, all you guys listening out there. Big up. Where he does some drugs and then blocks his misses, and then it's all downhill from there. Big cocaine spiral downwards into depression and being a complete and utter loser. He's just irritated that he's got caught for it, basically. There's no repentance going on here. So there is no case for salvation whatsoever.
Agreed.
Cocaine is a great drug to realise how short-lived pleasure can be and how big an asshole you can actually be as well for 50 quid a gram.
The verdict? Damnation.
Drinking is the ultimate loser's refuge. Alcohol and depression are the ugly sisters in the loser's pantomime. So here's one straight from the resident pianist at the loser's bar.
Resident what?
Pianist.
With you.
Tom Waits' early material was excellent on the subject of drinking, and On the Nickel is a great example of this. I first heard Tom Waits doing his Night Hawks at the Diner live double, which captures that kind of sleazy jazz poet side. And then he just completely changed and then came out of nowhere with Swordfish Trombones, which is one of the most astonishing records ever made. This is a song, it's a warning to boys to behave themselves, because if you don't, you're going to end up on the bum, on the nickel, in Skid Row, having lost everything through boozing. Here we go. This is Wheezing Tom Waits, On the Nickel.
Sticks and stones will break my bones. Always will be true. And when your mama's dead and gone, lullaby to you. What becomes of all the little boys who never comb their hair?
The short dogs grow.
That was Tom Waits with On the Nickel, a dire warning to aspiring alcoholics everywhere. This song inspired a film that very few people have actually seen called On the Nickel, which was about this ex-alcoholic searching for his friend on Skid Row, starring, of all people, the dad from the Waltons.
Oh, that must have looked so good in dungarees.
A lot of people don't like Tom Waits because of his voice. Other people like him because of it. He's one of those you either love or hate. What's your opinion, Grendel?
I can see why his voice divides opinion, but that's no bad thing, as I imagine someone like Tom Waits wouldn't give a tinker's cuss for either criticism or praise, but would have no truck with indifference. He sounds like he wears nicotine patches on his vocal cords. I like it, but I do now actually need a cigarette. He's saved by his mum, really, isn't he?
He is. He hasn't done anything yet. It's the mum telling the son, if you don't behave yourself, that's where you're going to end up. So he is actually saved.
It's like that thing, like your mum always used to say, like, where were you? We were worried sick. We thought that, you know, me and your father thought you'd been hurt or something like that. And then you get home that late and you haven't phoned, and then they threaten to kill you because you haven't been killed. It's a bit of a lose-lose situation, but not for Tom. I think he's definitely saved.
Mm. See, my mum was disappointed when I turned up.
Always listen to your mum.
Why? She's insane.
She's not insane, she's inside. She was disappointed when you turned up because she didn't have the cigarettes that she smoked. She'd know what she's like. I know Woodbine's tough to get hold of. Mother's love. You love your mother, don't you? Make the effort, Doc. Make the effort.
The verdict? Salvation.
Okay, here's another thing that people either love or hate. This is the Smiths.
Oh, boy.
I love these guys for their humour. They had style and they were unrepentant northerners. And they were proud of being northern when most music was London-based and before it was so-called cool to be northern, although apparently I'm northern and I've never been cool in my life.
Not apparently, you are northern, part A and part B, no shit.
I saw them do this, Charming Man, on the Tube. Remember
what,
that?
Bucking?
And
where were they? Well, at Charing Cross, the Smiths live at Charing Cross, at the bottom of the escalator, coming soon to a public help point near you. Stand, yeah, mind the gap. Mind the Northern Gap. Watford Gap. That's a gap they got to mind. They should have mined it. Mind is what they should have done. Not M-I-N-D. M-I-N-E-D. They should have mined the bloody Watford Gap and cut you guys off.
As I was saying,
miserable bunch of gits.
I thought this was superb. This is my favourite track by the Smiths. How soon is now?
Is it long?
Yeah.
We'll be right back.
That was the Smiths there with How Soon Is Now. He's the Queen of Self-Pity. What's your opinion on Morrissey?
What's my opinion on Morrissey? Well, how long have you got? How soon is now? I think what they're referring to there was how soon is the end of the song? Is it now? Is it really soon? Or have I got time to go away, have a slash, complete a PhD and raise a family? I do actually like this track, probably because it doesn't sound like anything else they've ever done. It's worth noting that this is without doubt, even by the band's own admission, the track of theirs that most people like, and I think it is because it doesn't sound like the other stuff. I don't hate this outfit. I just think that Moz is a bit of a preening arch twat at times. His interviews are hilarious, and there's a keen intellect at work, and there's a keen humour, a dry, sort of wry, observant humour running through most of their songs. But, Lord, it do sound dreary. He'd stand more chance of a Lego if he just bloody cheered up. Cracking guitar sound and one of the spookiest intros going, I think. Top tune, but there's scant salvation on offer here. Mozza, here's something else to whinge about. You're damned.
If you go to our website, lordsoftheether.com, you can check out a rather fantastic rendition of Morrissey's Visage by our resident music consultant, Guy Debord.
Hello.
Along with his other doodles, this is surely art worth dying for.
Indeed. Yeah. Those of you too drunk to drive home from our little soiree this evening will regrettably have no option other than to leave the keys to the hearse with the barkeep and spend the night at our sister establishment just across the street. It's the King. It's Heartbreak Hotel. Send a bottle up to my room.
Well, since my baby left me, well, I found a new place to dwell. Well, it's down at the end of Lonely Street, that Heartbreak Hotel. You're so lonely, baby. Well, I'm so lonely. I'll be just so lonely, I could die.
Although it's always crowded, you still can find some room for broken hearts.
to cry there in the blue. I'll be so, I'll be so lonely, baby. I'll be so lonely. I'll be so lonely, I'll make a die.
Man, the bellhop's tears keep flowing. The desk clerk's dressed in black. Well, they've been so long on the street. They'll never, never look back and think of something. You're so lonely, baby. Well, you're so lonely. Well, you're so lonely, and they could die.
Well, if your baby leaves you, you got a tale to tell. Or just take a walk down the lonely street to heartbreak hotel, where you will be. But you're so lonely, baby. Well, you'll be lonely. You'll be so lonely, you could die.
That was a King there with Heartbreak Hotel. All hotels have an element of bleakness in them, and Heartbreak Hotel is no exception. I think that the bridal suite at Heartbreak Hotel is a single bed and a copy of Razzle. There's always a room free here at Heartbreak Hotel, just opposite the More Than a Feeling studio. What's the verdict for Elvis?
Damnation! The jury has found losers worthy of damnation by a count of 6-4.
That's time, ladies and gentlemen. The Lords of the Ether are closing down the losers' bar. Ain't you got no empty homes to go to? Join us next month when the Lords of the Ether hog the dance set and play some of the greatest rock and roll to emerge sweaty and sneering from the 50s. Race you to the jukebox.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Lords of the Ether have left this dimension. Thank you so much for listening to More Than a Feeling with your hosts, Grendel and Doc. You can commune again with Lords of the Ether at lordsoftheether.com.